How's it feel to be back, first of all?
Yeah, a little strange, not going to lie. Putting on the Rhinos colours to start with was a bit weird feeling, then driving down Kirksall Road, going to, you know, where the train, just getting little flashbacks of coffee shops that I used to go to. Because obviously, you don't go to this part of the city, really, unless you're obviously going training down Kirksall. So a bit of a trip down memory lane for myself. So it's good, though. It's really good, you know. There's a few old faces still here, which is good to see, and you know, a lot of new faces. So yeah, I'm really happy. It's a good buzz around the place as well, so it's good to be back.
Had you even considered what you might have done had an opportunity not presented itself at any club?
Not really. Obviously, I wanted to leave probably last year. I did ask for a transfer request last year, but I did obviously have a year left at Wigan with the year option, and it was just a case of my family moved back to Yorkshire. So that was the reason behind that early on in the year. But yeah, it got to a point where I had to see the year out, and then you know, I was more than happy to do that. And you know, it just kind of got a bit tricky towards the last few weeks. And yeah, obviously I made them aware that, you know, I was looking to leave, and you know, it was a question to them that would they let me go. And yeah, it unfolded like that, which you know, I probably didn't want to leave halfway through the season, you know, at the start of the year, but just things change and things just unfolded that way. So it is what it is, really. And then obviously the call from Gary when it came out, and I was quite surprised. Obviously, Leeds wanting any player back at Leeds is a rarity anyway in itself. So when I heard that Gary was interested in signing me, and he spoke to the coaches here, and yeah, they were pretty keen for me to help him out. I was more than happy to answer that. So yeah, I was really thrilled when I heard the news that Leeds were interested in. It's just a great fit at the moment, you know, just a club like Leeds, the magnitude of it. It's something that I'm really excited to be joining.
Obviously, the week before last, you had that incredibly scary incident, didn't you? Yeah. If it's not too painful for you to relive, can you just describe in your own words what happened?
Yeah, really strange one. Really strange. I had my first day at training. Was really happy. I had my smile from ear to ear. Come home, like I say, I was fine. Nothing wrong. My partner asked me to take the little boy out for a walk in his tricycle, so I was doing that. And yeah, about 20 minutes into the walk, I just started feeling a little bit dizzy, just a feeling of lightness. I became really light and a bit dizzy and a bit foggy. So every time I stopped and went on my knees to have a look at my son, I kind of came to. So I was like, oh, it's a bit weird, this. And then every time I stood up, I kind of got that feeling again. What I say to people is, if you get out of bed really quick and you stand up, or you stand up from a seated position, you feel a bit dizzy. That's how I was every time I was upright. So I knew I wasn't great. So I tried to phone my partner, and she weren't answering. She was getting ready. So I had to make a decision. Every time I stopped, my son tried to get out of the tricycle. So I thought, if I do that and he tries to get out and I have if something happens, then, you know, I was in the middle of a street. So I thought, right, I'll just try and get home as quick as I can. And I tried to like get a bit of a trot on, and I literally went down on the third time, stood back up. Yeah, and I came to, and I was just sat in the middle of the street. Obviously, the first thing I did was, where's my son Abel? And there was a woman straight in my face. So I was like, whoa, what's going on here? And then I made sure that I could touch my son. That was the first objective. And then I was a bit dazed for about 10 minutes, if I'm going to be honest. And I came to, and I was a bit confused as to what had gone on. Yeah, and that was basically it, really. But obviously, as the time's gone on, I've spoke to the medic who was there, and another woman joined, and then a man come in there about 50 minutes later to see if I was okay. I've just gone stiff, stood up, fell over, and then I've smashed my head on the floor, which has caused, which we think has caused the fit or whatever it may be. And then obviously I'd had quite a lot of blood coming out of my head. So it was, yeah, very unexpected. Obviously I felt a bit weird, but obviously I didn't expect all that to happen off the back of it. So Yeah, I've had all the tests. You know, I've been to a neurologist, been to see about my heart and everything like that. And I'm really good. I'm pretty fit, the doctor said. So it's just one of those things. I think we can put it down to maybe stress, and you know, I've had a lot going on the last probably 3 or 4 weeks, regarding Wigan, then coming home, and half my stuff's in Wigan, half my stuff's at home, and you know, trying to get a team sorted and training. So I think it's just been a bit like I've been all over the shop, and I've not been probably 100% healthy. Yeah, it's like I say, I've had all the tests. They've come back really positive. And I've just done the stages of training and loading and stuff like that. So I'm pretty good, mate. Like I say, I'm pretty happy. It's just one of those things where, yeah, it's a bit weird. It's just a bit dangerous, obviously, when I have my son. That's all. That's the main thing I'm a bit conscious about. But I'll come out the other side, mate. I'm all right.
It's good to see you looking so well now, mate. You mentioned you've come home to your family. Do you feel like you've come home rugby-wise?
I do a bit, yeah. Yeah. Like I say, I didn't really have anyone lined up at the time, because obviously that's not how you really do business. But I was, you know, me and Wigan were at a point where we knew kind of where it was going to go, and that's when I could really put the feelers out if you want. And there were a couple of offers there that I could have gone to different clubs. And yeah, like I say, Gary came in and expressed their you know, they're interested in where Leeds are at and where I'm at. I thought, you know, it's just a perfect fit for me. You know, it's like I say, back home, back to a place where I'm really familiar with the surroundings, the coffee, even though you say the coffee shops, you know, it's just that home feel about it. And I've had quite a lot of messages off people that, not necessarily my friends, but people who know me just from rugby or whatever like that. And they're really thrilled that I've come back to Leeds, and you know, I've not really spoken to them much when I've been at Wigan, so that just shows you how much, you know, they're interested in me playing for the Rhinos again. So yeah, it's just like a family feel to it here. You know, like I say, I have small faces that I've known for quite some time, and it's just a great fit, and you know, I'm feeling really good.
Just lastly from me, Zak, I don't think you'd be speaking to us now if you weren't going to play on Sunday. How's it going to feel making your second debut at Salford on Sunday?
I've not really thought about it, because last time I was thinking about it, I had ended up having a fit on the floor. But I'm really excited. You know, my family and friends are asking me for 500 tickets. If I could try and get that from Salford, it'd be lovely. But it's I've got a job to do. I'm gonna just keep it really simple. I'm 30 now, believe it or not. But you know, I've been at a place where you want to try and score 5 tries and do everything, and it's not quite happened really well. And you know, I've not played for a few weeks. I've not trained for a few weeks. I've had something that's happened to me, you know, not so long ago. So I'm just going to keep it really simple. You know, my effort's never questionable. I hope not anyway. So I'm going to just give everything that I've got to give, and just be as good as I can be, and you know, hopefully get some wins on the board for Leeds and try and get them up to the top right end of the table.
Talk to the voice of experience. What were your head tests like?
My what, sorry?
Your head tests. Your neurologist tests and everything.
Yeah, they were good. They were spot on. All the brain parts were really good. There was no inflammation of it or anything like that, which, you know, I was a bit sceptical of. Obviously, having a big impact on the floor. They found a brain at, to begin with, so that was a start. So I was happy with that. Apart from that, mate, everything was really good, which I was really happy with. And then obviously the heart was really strong, and the doctor said I'm quite fit, which, you know, made me smile when he said it. But yeah, like I say, all the main tests came out really positive, so I was really happy.
Was it like an MRI scan you had?
Yeah, I had a few. Yeah, I had a couple of scans. The MRI one was the main one that they could really delve into and see the 4 different parts of the brain, which, like I say, which were all clear.
It's almost like a learning experience for you as well, isn't it? I remember my MRI scans and looking at it, and you're like, oh yeah, like it's a real sort of learning experience, isn't it? Like you sort of know a lot more about basically what's in the top of your head.
Yeah, like I said, I was pleased that they found something to start with, and then I went from there. So. Yeah, like I say, it's good. I reckon people should just have a checkup anyway, just to see how you're going along. But yeah, I was really, I was a bit nervous to get the results. Obviously, playing rugby league, you never know what's going to happen. You take that many bumps and knocks along the way. So, yeah, just to get a healthy scan was great. And, you know, I've just come from there, really.
When the results came back okay and you were clear and healthy of everything, was one of the first questions you asked, like, what if I'm tackled heavy and get a real heavy impact in the tackle? How can that affect me?
If I'm going to be totally honest, the first question is, can I play?
Yeah.
I'm always said to myself, if I get the professionals to say I'm clear and I'm healthy, I'm good enough to go. Other than that, mate, I'm not going to worry about it too much. Like I said, I've been playing for a long time, and all sorts can happen in rugby league. I'm not that stupid, but I'm not worried about it at all, mate. I'm just going to go along. I've tried to go on with daily business as normal and do the things I've been doing, which is perfectly fine. And say my training stuff that I've been taking into steps, I've been doing that, ticking that off nicely, and yeah, I'm not going to worry about it too much, mate.
Something like that can change your outlook on life, can't it? Would that be fair to say that it's changed the way you look at things, maybe?
I've done it a few times. The old what is life, and you know, you can dive into it quite deep, but it was I think someone put on, I tweeted it a few years ago, and someone like reposted it, and it's like I've tweeted something like, life's quite short, live it while you can. And it was only a young kid who'd done it, and it pinged up on my phone, and I looked at it, and I was like, well, I wrote that 2 years ago, why don't I just start like living like that? Do you know what I mean? So yeah, it's a scary thing that's happened. I don't think I've like thought about it too much. I think, you know, my parents and my partner, they've looked at it a bit like, are you okay? I'm like, yeah, I'm fine. I've not looked at it too much, but yeah, it's really scary. Like I say, I've just gone for a walk with my son. I felt absolutely fine before, and something like that happens, it's really scary. If I worked somewhere where it was quite public, and some fortunate to have a paramedic that's got older me, it could be a different story. So it's really scary when you start thinking about it, but such is life, really. So I just try and get on with it.
Do you feel lucky twice over? Lucky to have come through something like that relatively unscathed, and lucky to have basically got your old job back at Leeds?
Yeah, I think I'm really fortunate to be at Leeds anyway, and then to have a club like Leeds look after me, you know, send me to the top people to get it done quite quickly. I was really fortunate position to be at a club like Leeds who can, you know, get the right people looking after me. So I was really fortunate, and I've sent my thank yous to the right people who's got me involved. That, you know, there's a team of doctors here and people looking after me have been second to none, been outstanding. Been ringing me every 10 minutes when it happened, and then just seeing how I've been at training, coming up to me constantly. And yeah, they've been nothing but amazing, to be honest. So like I say, I've just left it to the guys who know what's been going on. I've been really fortunate in that sense.
Just one last one for me, because there's a lot of people queuing up to ask questions. I mean, what would you say about the way Wigan made out, the way, the reason you left? Like, they sort of made out sort of very sort of your indiscipline that sort of cost you, really. Would you agree with that, or would you sort of dispute that?
I'm not sure. It's a bit like fish and chip paper for me now. They could have worded it any way they wanted, to be honest. I was a bit wary of how they worded it. It could come across that I've done something bad when I really haven't. So, but when I started speaking to clubs about me coming back to Yorkshire, you know, we worked that through, and it's always going to be like people like yourself and people who's not really in the media just to have their opinions of what it could be and what it can't be. So I've had my fair share of that over the years, so I'm not really too bothered about that. But yeah, the right people know what's happened and or what's not happened. And yeah, like I say, I'm just really fortunate to be at a club like Leeds. And yeah, just it's just unfortunate that something happens like that, that, you know, gets something else speaking about and takes away from the rugby. But it's like I say, I've had a few years practice at that, and I was looking forward to playing.
Just on what Guy was saying there, I mean, obviously, yeah, people say you've had second chances at numerous times throughout your career. Did you think that you might not get another chance this time around?
No, I thought I would, but I didn't really expect Leeds, if I'm going to be honest. Like I say, I've not done too much at Wigan. I've not done anything wrong. Like I say, I could go go down the rabbit hole of what's really all happened and stuff. But I asked for a release last year. I was living in Wigan on my own. My young family's in Yorkshire. I was playing on the wing. There's a lot of factors that goes into me wanting to leave Wigan. You know, it's not an easy decision because obviously a club like Wigan's massive and it's been brilliant to me. The fans have been really accepting over the 3 years. The players, the staff have been really great. I've got no bad word to say about it whatsoever. It's just it just happens that my family lived in Yorkshire and she wouldn't want to move back over to Wigan, and I had to live in Wigan. So it's just it took a bearing on my relationship, and most important for me now, especially coming to ripe old age of 30, and we've got another child that's due in 8 weeks. The main thing for me is my family, and that comes first. So that was quite an easy decision for me to have. So it was just how it probably ended wasn't the best, but that's what the conversation we're getting had behind closed doors anyway. So I'm pretty happy with it. So it is what it is, and you know, we're gonna move on. You know, it was great to see them get to the Challenge Cup final, and I'm really happy for the boys there. I still speak to them. I've got no bad feelings towards the club or the players or the staff. So I'm just happy that they're happy, and we'll just move on.
And yeah, just on the back of that, it's obviously a World Cup year. Everything that's happened this year, obviously you're in that England squad, but is there a worry that you might go through your career without making a World Cup? Obviously, you've missed the last two, haven't you, for various reasons. Is that something you're concerned about? Are you confident you can get in that squad come the end?
To be honest, when it all came out with Wigan, obviously, with Wayne being at Wigan as well, I was probably under the illusion that a World Cup spot might not be up for grabs. But it's just one of those where I'm just going to be playing as well as I can on the pitch, and whether I get picked or not, it's up to the powers that may be. But like I say, I think Gary touched on it. He said, "Oh, do you look on life a little bit different?" And I probably do. And it's just as long as I'm happy, and my family's good, and the people around me are good, I'm happy. Yet it was a massive goal for me at the start of the year. I was living in Wigan, like I say, on my own, and I had to probably put things in place for me to get through this year. You know, it was always going to be a tough year for me, away from rugby, just with my family. It was a really big push for me. So, like I say, there is a World Cup at the end of the year. Obviously, you get picked on performances and stuff like that. So I've just got to try and get back on the pitch and play as well as I can.
Just back to the incident and the paramedic. Did she just happen to be walking past then when you fell?
No, it just so happens that I did it outside the house that she lived in. And I don't think she saw me. I think the husband saw me fall over, or just fall over, yeah. I just came to when she was in her face. So I was a bit like, what's going on, to be honest? I didn't really know what's going on. Like I mentioned, I was just conscious of where my son was. And obviously I did remember that I had my son with me. So I tried to stand up and I wanted to go home. Obviously she's a professional in her job and she knew what to do, and she was terrific. She stayed with me until she had to order an ambulance, but it said it was going to take over an hour to come. So I was just sat on the pavement for 45 minutes, and then when my partner's mum came to look after my son, my partner just took me to A&E, and I was there for about 5-6 hours. So it was a long old slog, but I was really fortunate to just, like say, something like serious as this to happen outside someone's door that knows exactly how to deal with these kind of things.
Yeah, and if she wasn't there and the incident didn't happen there, I mean, do you feel, without putting it too bluntly, could you have died? Like, do you feel lucky to be alive?
Like I say, I've not a clue, mate. I really don't know. Like going into loads of detail and speaking to the doctors and what they know and what they don't know, they do think the fit or the seizure, whatever you might want to call it, has happened from the impact of me falling down. So I don't know if I'd have landed on grass, would it have been different? I don't know, maybe. But yeah, like I say, I didn't feel any what poorly or any funniness before I set off walking, because I wouldn't have gone for a walk. Like I say, I'd just come back from training. I'd been really happy. I was buzzing, to be honest. So yeah, just something like that can happen when I was at my, well, I felt at my best. I probably weren't going back into it, but yeah, it's really scary. Like I say, I was fortunate for it to happen about 2 minutes away from my house, but fortunate even more to have a paramedic come out and look after me. So really grateful for that, yeah.
What's her name, Zach, if she's happy?
She's called Rosie, mate, yeah. I've been speaking to her since, and she's a lovely woman. She's been great, so really fortunate.
Obviously, not like most people in life, you've made some mistakes and bad choices in your career. You've also had some great highs with various clubs that you've played at. How would you just sum up your career? Because obviously you said you're 30 now, and you know it seems to have gone by in a flash. How would you sum up your career today?
I'd have no regrets. Obviously, hindsight's a wonderful thing, and if I didn't do X, Y, and Z, you know, certain things wouldn't happen. If I had to stop and just pause for a second and think about it, I'm really happy. Could I have done more? Absolutely. But if you'd said to me at 7 year old writing a story at junior school that I want to be a professional rugby player, and I told all the teachers I didn't want to do my homework because I want to do this at rugby league and this and this, I'd have took it with a heart, you know, to get in a heartbeat. So I'm not one of those that I'm going to kick the dirt and like, oh, I should have done this, should have done that. It's gone now. So, like you said, I've had some wonderful times. I've had some not great times, but not the great times have helped me in some way or another. I'm pretty sure of that. And then it just helps me just give the advice to probably someone else, a younger lad or a younger person. And obviously my son, and then whether I'm having a boy or a girl, I'm not quite sure yet, but my kids as well. And that just helps me in later life. So obviously rugby is a really short career, and then you go into the big wide world, and then it gets a little bit scary, I think. So I'm happy with what I've done, mate. I really am. Like I say, I could have done more, but it's one of those where I'm not going to beat myself about it and just crack on and move on.
Do you feel like you owe Leeds a debt of gratitude for giving you this chance to finish your career on a high?
I won't put it into those words. Like obviously, I wanted to come home to Yorkshire. I was open with the idea of what club wants me, if I'm honest. But then obviously when Leeds came in, I was a bit taken back. I was a bit taken back. Obviously, get a phone call from
why were you so surprised? Why were you so surprised that Leeds wanted you back?
I don't know. Just from experience at being at the club for many years, being what the club's about, I know exactly what it's like inside and out. The people, the powers that may be in the club, I know what kind of people they are as well. And I just thought, yeah, it probably won't happen back at Leeds. Like I say, I was pretty open to where I could have come and what was next for me rugby wise. So yeah, like I say, when Gary got in touch, I was quite surprised that Gary got in touch, and then I spoke to Jamie Jones, and then I spoke to Rowan, and yeah, it came a little bit strange. I'll admit that. I rang my mum and said, "You never guess who just rang me." But and she was the same. She was a bit taken back as well. But yeah, everyone really close to me is really happy that Leeds have come back, and I've said yes to Leeds. They've said yes to me. It's just about going on a journey together now this year and try and finish as strongly as possible.
Just touching on a few of the topics that have been covered. You mentioned the woman Rosie who looked after you. Have you been able to sort of express your gratefulness for what she's been able to do for you? Because it obviously could have been a damn sight worse had she not been there.
Yeah, I think I'd have to go to her house every week for flowers for the rest of the year to show that. Because I don't think I could put into words how grateful I am. I know I probably put it off a bit. It's just for my son, really, just for someone to be there. I think I'm more grateful for that. Obviously, for myself, it's one of those things that happened and I came around and I'm okay. But yeah, it could have been a different matter if no one were there at all and my son just got out of his tricycle and toddled off somewhere. I'd have really found that hard to deal with. But yeah, just someone as nice as her just happens to be there, and it just so happens she's a paramedic, just adds to it a little bit more, doesn't it? So yeah, I'm probably indebted to her for quite some time. So I'll have to see if she wants the garden doing or something like that and try and do it in her spare time. But no, she's a fantastic lady. She was really nice. And she got my girlfriend's number after as well to just text her and see how I was doing. So she's checked upon me as well, which has been which has been lovely. Like I say, I can't say thanks enough to her, to be honest. She's been brilliant. Like I say, she only lived 2 minutes down the road as well. So, yeah, I'm forever indebted to her, to be honest.
You've spoken a lot about your young'un and your partner during this interview. Did it get to a point where you had to be back around here full-time permanently to ensure that, that was kept intact? Because it's obviously, there are stresses when you're long-distance partners, especially when there's a kid involved as well. Did it get to that point where you just had to be together to make sure everything was happy and healthy?
Yeah, pretty much, mate, yeah. It was, pre-season were tough anyway. I tried to get home as much as possible, but we were finishing training at 3, and then if anybody knows the M62 corridor, it's an absolute nightmare. So sometimes I'm getting home at like 8 o'clock and Abel, my son's already in bed and I'm not seeing him, so I'm a bit peeved off with that. And then I was getting up for training the next morning at 5 o'clock and he gets up about 7. So I was missing him altogether. So I was like, well, there's no point in me being here. And yeah, I've had all the conversations of a partner or a husband not being at home. I've had all those. And yeah, it was really getting to me. And I did say, like, I lived in Wigan for 6 months. I got a 6-month rental in Wigan to show that I didn't want to be at Wigan. I thought it'd change a little bit, but it really didn't. And then obviously, my partner's due again in about 10 weeks. So the idea behind it was I was always going to move back to Yorkshire probably about this time anyway. So obviously, I can't have raised 2 kids, especially my 2 kids at home on their own in Yorkshire and me being in Wigan. I didn't want to be that kind of parent either. So yeah, it was always going to be like that, I think. It just materialised a little bit different to what I probably imagined. But like I say, nothing really happens how you want it to, does it, really? So I just had to get on with things, how the pen panned out. And I think I've done all right from that, you know. Like I say, I've moved back into my house and put all my clothes back into my own drawers. And it just feels really good to be home. And then just a club like Leeds, like I've mentioned earlier, like I know it back to front kind of more or less. It's just great to be back.
And just very finally, you mentioned positions, and I don't think it's a secret that, you know, you like playing fullback, you don't mind playing centre. I know you said you're happy to do what you're doing now, but with one eye on next year, which I know you said you've not right now, but is that going to be a consideration for you, whatever your next move may be, whether that be Leeds, wherever, that you got to that age where you know what you want to do, you know where you want to play, yep. That's going to kind of be a contributing factor to what's next?
Yeah. Yeah, I think for next year, obviously, like I say, I've not really thought that much into it, I'll be honest. But like I'm 31 in October. I still feel about 25. My body's great. It's just numbers, age is a number, isn't it? But yeah, I think going forward for next year, the position where I play and am I going to be cemented in it? I don't want no guarantees, because obviously nothing's guaranteed in rugby league and young lads are coming up through the ranks. Left, right and centre, there's some absolutely fantastic talent coming through, but I'd like probably a bit of reassurance of where I'm at and what kind of my role is within the team and stuff like that. Obviously, you don't want to be, like I say, in your 30s, bouncing between 4 different positions, because I've done that the last year and a half, and I didn't particularly like it that much, you know. I was quite strong in my views of what I wanted to be, and I was trying to do the best for the team, and I thought I did that. But yeah, like I say, going forward, being able to sign a new contract for the next couple of years, whether it may be whatever club, you can express yourself a little bit more, especially when I've played the game for a number of years now. So yeah, that'll be a thought process into that, mate.
Like you say, you're only 30, but is Jack Sinfield making you feel a bit old, given you played with with his dad in your first spell?
Yeah, very much so, yeah. Especially when I sat down for breakfast and I was shouting Cine. I was like, oh, God. But yeah, it does. I can remember seeing Jack, obviously, over 10 years ago. I can remember Kevin bringing him in, or I can remember seeing him at Wembley and, you know, Kevin and his wife and his son and his kids, you know. I can remember all that. And me and Bernie, 19, 20. So very strange, mate. Very weird. I say Phil sat here. He was still here as well. But, Glyn Bell, the kit man, he's still here. It's just... It's funny, but it's a warm feeling that you get, like I say, just coming back and seeing the old faces and just getting old memories flashing before you. But like I say, seeing Jack was a bit of a head turn. Yeah, it does make you feel a bit old.
What are your first impressions of him as a player? Can you see a bit of his dad in him?
Yeah, I can very much so. Yeah, funny enough, we just done some kicking a few sticks after this session, and he kicks a little bit like his dad. I know we're talking a bit like talking through his kicking and stuff like that. But yeah, he's pretty brave with the ball, like his dad was. Really brave, goes into deep into the line, which in a half you really want. And I know the people at this club rate him really highly, not just because of his dad, but he's actually really good in his own right, which you need to be. I think if you've got a famous dad, or you know a great dad who's done great stuff in rugby league, he'd be a real man. And I think just from last couple of weeks from him being around the place, he's certainly doing that. And I've seen Leeds play a few times this year, and when he's played, he's gone above and beyond. You know, he's only a small kid, but he's pretty good, mate.
Yeah, and you mentioned the players who are coming back. When you look at those guys, and you're only a third of the way through the season, or more or less, is a playoff place still attainable?
I really believe so, yeah. I don't see why not. I think it could be, I don't know, maybe 4 or 5 wins off, and you need a few of them clubs at the top just to lose a couple of games, and we're probably in sixth, you know, and then you can go wherever from there. Obviously, we're going to say it's the two teams at the minute, they're going really well. Obviously, great game at the Challenge Cup last week. And it just seems to feel like anyone from third down, you know, it's a scrap for those places. So yeah, like I say, I had a little dig in myself just to have a look at the points difference and where I feel the club could finish. And there's no reason why we can't finish top 6, 100%.
Mm. And you've got experience doing it from fifth, of course, haven't you?
Yeah, I've won it from fifth at the time. So yeah, it's experience is there, but I don't think we call on that.
Yeah.